for joining us. Welcome from me, Michael Scott, currently in France, but shortly to return to Oxford, and from my joint convener, Sanford J. Ungar, in Washington, D.C., to the 34th jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Initiative and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, and freedoms in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand over to Sandy, who is the director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished guests and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session. Now, for that session, we'd like you to send in your questions, please. To do so, will you use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen? The Q&A button, please, not the chat button. These questions will come to me during the session, and I will try to put them to the panel to consider. We urge you, please, to ask questions as and when they occur to you so that we don't get a bottleneck at the end. I'm really looking forward to today's discussion. We've got a great panel lined up for you. And with that, I hand over to Sandy.
Thank you very much, Mike. We are returning once again to the subject of the war in Ukraine, the Russian invasion of Ukraine and its ongoing aftermath, because our participants and our panelists and people who follow these programs have expressed ongoing interest, and many of them ultimately watch these programs online on YouTube and other websites. So we end up with, in some cases, thousands of viewers who continue to be interested in these analyses in general, but especially of the Ukraine-Russia situation and how much we really know about it. I think the panel we've assembled today has very interesting and special perspectives on it. Let me begin by introducing Anna Blackman from the University of Glasgow, where she is a lecturer on Catholic religious education. Michael Kimmage, professor of history at Catholic University in Washington, department chair of the history department there. And Michael is chair also of the Advisory Council of the Kennan Institute at the Woodrow Wilson Center for International Affairs in Washington. The Kennan Institute, named for the late George Kennan, diplomat, scholar, focuses particularly on Russian affairs. And so it's often a repository we go to for deep knowledge about Russia. David Jones, Member of Parliament, Conservative Member of Parliament from a constituency in Wales. He has been in the House of Commons for 18 and a half years, and I think knows a great deal about the strength of support for Ukraine in the United Kingdom and whether this is something that people have to worry about or think deeply about. And also Ian Linden, who is a visiting professor at St. Mary's University in London, where he teaches about social justice. So I'd like to begin by asking what's changed. You were not the same group of people who talked about this with us lately, but what's changed since the Wagner group seemingly collapsed, although I'm not sure we all know the last word or have seen the last of the Wagner group, but certainly the death of Yevgeny Prigozhin in an air crash that was widely suspected to be engineered by the Russian authorities seems to have certainly changed the picture. But what difference has that made? Is that we thought that it would weaken the Russian side in the war, and yet the Ukrainian side seems to be in stalemate. So, Michael, do you have some insights on that for us, Michael Kimmage?
Sure. And first of all, thank you so much for the invitation to speak with this group and to address this audience, sort of the current audience and the future one that will come to us virtually. I think that you can make two slightly separate points about where things are in Russia. The first, I think, is probably the more important point, which is that with the military effort, you know, whatever chaos Prigozhin brought to Russia on the 24th of June and whatever chaos his death or assassination may bring, it's not changed anything fundamental about the Russian war effort. In a sense, Prigozhin had already rendered his service by taking the city of Bakhmut and probably was more integral to Russian activities in Africa than he was on the battlefield in Ukraine, at least by the summer of 2023. That the basic structures that enable Russia to continue its war and to prosecute are still there and will be there with or without Prigozhin, and certainly Putin's intent to continue on with the war is, if anything, perhaps a bit stronger than it was at the beginning of the summer. So the big picture has not changed, and there was a temptation, I think I myself fell victim to this, to overinterpret Prigozhin's mutiny and to look for cracks in the edifice that may not have been there. At the same time, I think that there's a variable that Prigozhin identified. This would be my second point. And this is a kind of slow boil of discontent of soldiers at the front, Russian soldiers at the front, and perhaps with the larger war effort within Russian society. This is very difficult to judge from the outside, but not only was Prigozhin able to mount a mutiny of the kind he did in June, but it seemed like it was greeted with a degree of warmth by the people on the streets of Rostov-on-Don, and the Russian elite didn't particularly rally around the figure of Putin this summer. So it may not be cracks in the edifice. Maybe we need another metaphor, but there is something boiling perhaps under the surface. Perhaps it's there with the soldiers, perhaps it's in the general population. And I think that that evokes a kind of tolling of a political bell for Putin, that all of this may not go on forever.
Anyone else have any thoughts about that? David, I think we should turn to you because you were actually in the House of Commons today, I believe. And there was an initiative to ban people affiliated with the Wagner group from the United Kingdom. Is that right?
Well, indeed. And in the last 10 minutes, the House of Commons has voted to proscribe Wagner as a terrorist organization. This broadcast is perhaps timely. But really, I'd like to follow on from what Michael was saying. Prigozhin's intervention in June was really quite extraordinary. He had been extremely provocative over the previous few months. He'd been more or less personally offensive to the Russian defense minister, Shoigu, and also to Medvedev, the prime minister. Marching on Moscow was an extraordinary thing. And of course, what was even more extraordinary was when he abandoned his attempt to overthrow Putin, Putin didn't immediately have him arrested and shot. He's apparently now been assassinated. According to recent reports from a Russian analyst, he is not dead, but he's living on the island of Margarita in Venezuela. You know, it just sort of exemplifies what Churchill said about Russia, which was that it's a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma, and nothing really changes. From my own perspective, I would think that the loss of Prigozhin, despite the fact that he was so disruptive, must have come as a loss to Putin also. For a start, the Wagner forces were probably among the most effective forces in the Donbass, and arguably they saved Putin's bacon on more than one occasion. Also, of course, the very fact that that Prigozhin mounted this attempted coup highlighted that Putin is not invincible. He's very far from invincible. He is actually quite vulnerable. I think that really we're still seeing playing out the consequences of Prigozhin's intervention and arguable subsequent death. I think there's a lot more to come, and probably in the immediate future too.
I feel I should interrupt you for a second here to just ask whether you think it's true that he's actually living alive and living on an island in Venezuela.
I think it's probably unlikely. The Russian analyst in question has got a reputation for being a bit of a conspiracy theorist. On the other hand, who knows?
Well, that would certainly send all the intelligence agencies into a recalculation of things if their earlier conclusions were wrong. Anna Blackman, from your perspective, and you focus on especially on religious affairs, do you see any new prospects and any new basis for negotiation toward a some kind of settlement in this war?
I suppose I was just thinking sort of in light of what people were saying about Prigozhin. I think one thing that is significant about it, in terms of when we are thinking about sort of civil resistance and this sort of thing, the breaking up of or loyalty shifts within military, I think, is really important. And that does suggest some undermining of authority, or at least there are some forms of resistance. And whether that can be spread, I think the answer is probably, as Michael was saying, I feel perhaps I was being overly hopeful about it, but I think perhaps we just don't quite know the situation. In terms of negotiation, probably things like that increase internal pressure when there is dissidence, I think, especially within such close allies. In terms of religious negotiation, is that kind of what you're asking about, or sort of the presence of religious?
Yes, there's been talk about some sort of, since diplomacy seems to have failed, is there something in the religious domain that might be done to lead people to meaningful and important negotiations?
Yeah. So I think from my perspective, I think if we're thinking about does religion have to have a part to play in politics, I think I want to say definitely yes, in terms of having this shared common vision for life and how we work together. I think probably a couple of reasons why it is important in this situation. So I think in the first instance, there's signs of this already happening. So, for example, Orthodox clerics who've been speaking out against the war, instances of parish priests saying sermons condemning the war within Russia. And I think there has been some attempts at mobilization as well. So I know have been interreligious peace missions to Ukraine to try and also work with non-civil resistance there. I think there are historically evidences as well of religion being used as a mobilizing factor. So if we look at solidarity within Poland, that's a really good example of religion being used to mobilize civil actors. So I think there definitely is potential there. In terms of a larger kind of, maybe if we're thinking about religious leaders, another example that I was thinking about today was the role that John the 23rd had in the Cuban Missile Crisis. So trying to speak to both sides to de-escalate the conflict, perhaps not necessarily, I think Pope Francis has been quite careful in his language of trying to advocate for peace without necessarily using particularly sort of condemning language on either side, even though it's clear that he does support the Ukrainians' right to self-defense. So I wonder if that sort of negotiation could be a way forward. And I do think that religious leaders do have quite a unique role to play there, actually, in being able to sort of be in the political sphere, but slightly outside of it.
Ian, to change the subject a bit, there's a lot of talk now about the West, even though it does not have troops on the ground, so far as we know, or not authorized in Ukraine, the West beginning to tire of this war, and some, I don't know if it's fair to say loss of nerve, but some more ambivalence about whether the Ukrainian side will ever prevail. Donald Trump, for one, whose name seems to be mentioned in every such discussion again, it seems clear with his, maybe he's not rising in the polls anymore, but he's still well ahead of all other Republican candidates for next year's presidential nomination. It's well known that he is an admirer of Putin's and he's lukewarm about the Ukrainian war. So does that, while others may not find it imaginable, he is a serious possibility to be reelected president of the United States. So what are the implications of things like that? And is there a parallel track at all in the United Kingdom?
Well, I'd like to, if I may answer that, but just if I could just carry on and switch back to one of the former questions, because I'd like to make some comment, if that's all right. I think the first thing to say is that the chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff in the United States, General Mark Milley, was calling in November, first of all, fairly clearly, and then in a more muted way, because he got wrapped on his knuckles over it, for consideration of negotiation. He even compared the possibilities in Ukraine to those of what happened in the First World War, giving the example that if you'd negotiated early in the First World War, you would have had 1 million casualties. And as it was, you ended up with 20 million. And I think somebody like the Joint Chief speaking out like that is very important, because on the whole, public opinion, media, and so on, normally dismiss anybody that stands up and sort of talks about negotiation as naive. You're naive, or you're being sort of religious and living in a different sort of a world. Well, Joint Chiefs of Staff are not, on the whole, I would describe as naive, certainly not if you've reached that rank and you've survived being appointed by Trump and going on to work for Biden, which seems to me to be quite an incredible achievement in its own right. The second thing I'd like to say is just tracking back quickie on Prigozhin. He's a mercenary, and the mercenaries I've met both in London and in Africa tend to be fantasists. And quite frankly, trotting up the road with a few soldiers and shooting down a few aeroplanes on the way to Moscow is the act of a fantasist. Getting on an aeroplane in Moscow without having every sniffer dog for about 100 miles sniffing around your aeroplane and your luggage, you know, what head of state would go anywhere near an aeroplane without having the sniffer dogs over it? It's fantasy. Anyway, getting back to Anna's contribution, I think it is, I think that the role of people like Pope Francis and, say, the Franciscans, who internationally have done quite a lot of work, the role of organizations like Peace News in giving very accurate information about stuff that if you were to say it yourself in the mass media, all hell would break loose and you'd be trolled into oblivion also. I think all of that's very important. And Anna's right, the Pope's played a very, very difficult hand given the tradition of the papal diplomatic corps as mediators in trying to present themselves as neutrals, which is absolutely essential in a way for having any mediating credibility. And because of that, he said things like, to youth, he said things like about the great mother Russia and the Russian cultural heritage, and has been thoroughly upbraided for it as being a foolish and an inappropriate remark, despite the fact, as Anna said, it's perfectly obvious that the criminal aggression and war crimes of Russia are completely recognized by the Vatican. So I think it is an important role, but I think it's made much, much more difficult by the interaction between the Russian Orthodox Church and Putin, and Putin's way of manipulating Russian Orthodoxy to be, as it were, the cement in the absence of communism from the Soviet Union. And I remember being in Moscow and talking to Gorbachev's advisors, religious advisors, and them saying, "What will we do now we've lost communist ethics, communist morality," in inverted commas, I thought. And they were looking at for some religious sort of answer to that, or perhaps the Russian Orthodox. And I remember saying to them, "No, you know, lots and lots of Pentecostal churches will move in. You won't, you cannot expect the Christian church." But he went on, it clearly, to want to, as it were, get the Russian military officers much more involved with, and they're sent to Russian Orthodox monasteries around Mount Arafat and spend time there, as it were, brushing up on Russian Orthodox piety. I think the fact that you have Kirill, who is a KGB asset and is clearly completely compromised as a part of that whole story, as well as thoroughly strongly resisting, as it were, Russian Orthodox, is a bit of a problem for the role of the church. And the Catholic Church has always been not exactly a top priority for Russian regimes. I mean, the Catholic Church has had a pretty hard time there in the past.
And if I may, there is, of course, an historical precedent, because at the Tehran conference, Churchill asked Stalin to consider the stance of the Pope. And the Pope and Stalin famously replied, "How many divisions has the Pope got?" To which Churchill said to an aide, "This man has completely lost contact with reason." Stalin simply didn't understand the importance of the Pope and the Catholic Church, and it's probably a mistake that Vladimir Putin will repeat.
So, Ian, I don't know if you want to come back to my other question, prematurely asked, perhaps, about...
Sorry, did I forget that?
a weakening of resolve. I'm going to think of everyone's comments about this.
Yes, yes.
Weakening of resolve in the West, which I think is a very important factor at this stage. If Zelensky is going to hold people together and keep going and continue to project this... albeit damaged optimism nonetheless.
Yeah, I think it's very important for the resolve to be firm with as much international coherence. I mean, we've got Hungary sort of dithering around and not exactly being very helpful in Europe. And we've got the Republicans probably now moving much more into an isolationist, what are we doing in this sort of funny place over there? So I think that does need to, obviously, but I'm sure Michael Kimmage would agree, and it does need to be countered fairly strongly. But I think we do need to take into account that also would make the possibility of negotiation move up from absolutely sort of zero at the moment, as it looks, to some degree of possibility. And the other thing is a bit of memory. March 22nd, 2022, they were very near an agreement, and it was basically scuppered by Johnson and the Biden government not wanting the Ukrainians to go down that road at that moment, and of course by the Bucha massacres. But they, if you looked at it, the 10-point plan and the idea that you would exchange security guarantees from the United States and Britain and so on. And it was the unwillingness of the British and I think the United States to give security guarantees in the belief that Russia wouldn't honor them that was behind it. But at that point, the Ukrainians were willing to put Crimea on the back burner, which of course is something that is very much on the front burner for Russia. So there was a possibility there and it was lost. And almost immediately afterwards, you had the annexation of the the regions in eastern Ukraine. And since then, of course, I think its negotiation has become increasingly difficult, particularly because Ukraine now bans any negotiation by decree. And I mean, it's not all sweetness and light. An interesting new thing, I would say, not particularly new, but quite recently, Putin has been saying, you know, how could we do negotiations if it's banned by Ukraine? And he did call upon the Ukrainians to lift the ban on negotiation to see, you know, what could be possible. Now it sounds as if I'm being naive again. You know, it's very difficult to talk that talk and walk that walk without being accused of not recognizing that Putin's a monster. Michael, sorry.
Yes, Michael Kimmage, maybe you could pick up some of these.
Would make three quick points in response to the question about sort of Western resolve vis-a-vis Western fatigue. And the first is that if you look only at policymakers, the story of the war is very clear, and it's an accelerating degree of support for Ukraine. The F-16s are going to come at some point. I think that that's pretty clear. And if you look at where the West was at the beginning of the conflict, every few months, a new threshold has been passed in terms of the sophistication of the weaponry. And I would assume that that trend is going to continue far into the future. So I think that's probably the most important point to make, that for people with decision-making power, it's not less support for Ukraine than you see. It's more. And I really doubt that that's going to change anytime soon. So the second point is that even in places where you've had elections that have sort of gone a little bit outside the foreign policy mainstream, so this would be Italy and Sweden most recently, once the people who are elected come into power, they behave as mainstream European or sort of Western politicians on the subject of Ukraine. I think Meloni would be the most interesting instance of this. And of course, Hungary, which Ian already mentioned, is a kind of outlier, but at the same time, they've won concessions from the European Union because of being an outlier. They haven't changed the policies of the European Union toward Ukraine or the policies of European countries. So even the countries that are sort of not fully on board end up being on board in practice. And I also don't think that this is going to change anytime soon. But the third point would take us in a somewhat different direction. And this is what you could describe as kind of rising far-right sentiment, especially in Germany, where the AfD is polling over 20%. And you see this as a Europe-wide trend. You know, the Spanish election recently sort of underscored this, even though the far-right didn't come into power there. But there, too, the trend line is pretty clear. And I think it's obvious in the U.S. that for the Republican candidates, it's not just Trump, the Ukraine skeptic who's popular, but it's also Ramaswamy and DeSantis, the two next most popular politicians, yeah, also among the most Ukraine skeptical of all the Republican candidates. So that's an important data point. And very finally, when it comes to politics, I think the challenge of Western supporters for Ukraine is to maintain support for Ukraine without a theory of victory. And that's going to be very, very hard to do. It's not to say that it's worthwhile or that the principles and the kind of imperatives aren't there when it comes to Ukraine, in my opinion, that they are. But as a matter of practical politics, long wars without a theory of victory, could just go into recent American history in this regard, are not easy to maintain.
Sandy, also, it's not just a question of resolve. There's some very practical military issues involved in the sense that there isn't enough, apparently, I was reading, not enough 150 millimeter shells available. So the net result is that the United States has had to resort to sending fragmentation bombs and things of that sort, which, you know, I don't think the United States has signed the agreement, so I can't say that it's illegal for them. But certainly, and we're now sending armor-piercing uranium-type shells, anti-tank shells, which cause the most terrible havoc in Afghanistan, with lots of people, it's now thought, you know, suffering from cancer as a result of it and other disorders. We are in certain areas, I think, that's hardly being publicized, at the bottom of the barrel, literally, in terms of military ordnance. And I think that equally is the case with the Russians. I mean, why have we got this sort of visit from Korea? It's presumably because Korea can shovel some of its military ordnance in the direction of Russia in return for some information on how to get its guided missiles more effective, its telemetry more effective.
I must say that scenario of Putin meeting with Kim Jong-un is a highly unlikely one that anyone might have predicted. And I don't know whether it's taken seriously as a sign of spreading support for Russia, or if it's a sign of desperation and the only place to turn. I don't think the jury is in on how to interpret that. David, do you have any thoughts about that?
Yeah, it looks very much to me as if Putin is running out of ordnance. We know that North Korea has got a huge stockpile of ordnance. A lot of it is very old. A lot of it is probably very unreliable. But nevertheless, they are in a position to feed it to Putin. I actually think that this particular development is extremely dangerous because we've seen that Kim Jong-un has been trying for some considerable time to find a reliable way of delivering the nuclear weapons that he apparently has got. Russia, of course, has got the rocket technology. It's interesting that they've met at a rocket base about 500 miles away from Vladivostok. And, you know, frankly, two unstable heads of state talking to each other about how best to prosecute a war in Europe and how best to arm the other against its enemies or perceived enemies in the Far East strikes me as a recipe for considerable danger. And I think it's something we should be concerned about.
And then let's go back to this question of popular support or reliable endorsement by members of the public of this Western strategy, not sending troops apparently, but sending weaponry and diplomatically supporting Ukraine. You're in Glasgow. I don't know if you're there at the moment, but you spend a fair amount of your time in Glasgow. And do you think there is support at that distance from Westminster? Is there support for this government policy of backing the Ukrainians?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I think there's probably, I actually was going to ask Michael about this, but I think, and maybe David knows a bit more, but I can see two sides to it. I think on the one side, there definitely is support in terms of, I think fear of Russia and keeping the war contained within Ukraine, perhaps, so supporting the war efforts there. But I do wonder, and I don't think I know the answer to this, but I do wonder how much support there is in terms of, I think here and probably America, people dealing with economic fallout from it and sort of economic hardship and increasing as the war continues, and especially with elections coming up, whether that is, I suppose creating some sort of fatigue with the situation. I think probably the other issue to think about in terms of Glasgow is nuclear weapons. So Trident being based in Faslane, and there is a lot of antagonism around that, the nuclear weapons base being based in Scotland. So I think that's
a factor that hasn't been mentioned and hasn't been in that I've seen in the media and discussions of this.
Yeah. So
that is an interesting, certainly interesting point to raise. Mm-hmm. Michael Kimmage, I was a little surprised by your certainty over American support. After all, there is this presidential election looming in less than 14 months now. And in early November next year, are you confident that come what may, politically, American military support will be there?
Well, not entirely. You know, obviously Trump is a great wild card, and he's claimed that he could resolve the crisis in 24 hours if he were given the chance, which sounds a lot to me like he would concede to Russian terms in a negotiated settlement, which wouldn't certainly equal sustained military support. But I would put the point this way. I think the United States is contradictory on the subject of Ukraine. I don't think that the general population at this point cares all that much. It sounds a little bit maybe impolite to put it in those terms, but other issues have come in. It's no longer getting the media attention it did at the beginning of the conflict. And this sort of slightly interminable quality to it is, I think, inducing a lot of Americans to tune out. And the great political risk for the Biden administration or for anybody else who's going to be in power is that the Ukraine conflict starts to resemble the conflict in Afghanistan, just sort of psychologically. If that's the case, then the U.S. is going to start to really question what it's doing in Ukraine and may move in a different direction. But I don't think any American politician is going to want to own, quote unquote, losing Ukraine. And I think that that includes Donald Trump. After all, when Trump is in power his first term, despite a lot of the noises he made on the campaign trail, he's the one who provides lethal military assistance to Ukraine. Under his watch, two new countries enter the NATO alliance. Military spending of, you know, U.S. military spending on Europe goes up. Under Trump, it doesn't go down. I don't even think Trump, who might be all over the map, would be all over the map rhetorically when it comes to Ukraine, is going to be the one who wants to hand Ukraine over to Russia. So that's a built-in constraint, even if the election goes away from the Democrats in 2024, and suggests to me that probably the U.S. will be where it is for the foreseeable future in terms of support to Ukraine.
It's interesting. Just to interject here, I live quite near the Russian embassy in DC, in Washington, D.C. And I remember when the Russians first invaded Ukraine, when there were 100,000 Germans on the street protesting the Russian invasion of Ukraine. And there was plenty of rhetoric in the United States, but there were virtually no demonstrations outside the Russian embassy. And it's not that people don't know where it is. That always made me think, just on the basis of totally unscientific neighborhood observation, made me wonder whether there was really, whether there was deep support in the United States, other than, of course, in areas where Ukrainian immigrants or people of Ukrainian ethnic origins live, in certain cities in the Midwest, et cetera. I was always suspicious of the strength of American support for it, and that it could be sort of easily knocked out. And I just wonder, in the UK, is there any kind of similar phenomenon? Have there been big outpourings, dramatic outpourings that the government had to notice? David, I don't know if you want to comment on that.
Yeah, I think so. I can't recall many demonstrations recently. There certainly were demonstrations in support at the beginning of the conflict. And I think wherever you travel right across the UK, you'll see that houses are flying Ukrainian flags, which is, you know, quite unusual for this country, because unlike the US, we tend not to fly flags and wave them. It's not really terribly British, but
we wave flags a lot.
Generally. I know you do, but we don't. But we've made a strong exception in the case of Ukraine. My perception is that there is still a strong level of support in the United Kingdom for Ukraine, and particularly for President Zelensky, who is a charismatic leader and who appeals to a lot of Brits.
He gets still a lot of ink in the United States and a lot of attention. Ian, just briefly, if you were an advisor to President, and let me say one thing before we go any further, that if people who are tuning into this program have questions, now would be an excellent time to put them into the Q&A link. We'll be coming back to Mike Scott in just a few minutes to pick those up. So this would be a good time to add any questions that our participants might have. But Ian, if you were an advisor to President Zelensky, he's had a couple of things that are a little difficult politically to handle: corruption in the military in Ukraine, people buying out of bribing their way out of the obligation to serve, some suppression of media attention domestically. And we don't really know how much access visiting correspondents have within Ukraine to this war. But what would you advise Zelensky right now if he asked you, Ian, how do I keep Western support? What do I have to do in this shaky time? And I dare say British as well as American politics, although David might not agree with that. But
I think the real problem for Zelensky is that he's in a way trapped in a very difficult situation. On the one hand, he's had to present to NATO countries where he needs the military equipment and armaments and so on, a position which is absolutely solid, no retreat, no letting Crimea sort of be put on the back burner for 15 years, as in the original agreement, a complete shutdown, as it were, on any type of concessionary negotiation. Whereas privately, he must know that he can't win this war. I mean, some of the sort of advisors in that have said that he's expressed the wish to negotiate, but saying, if I try to negotiate, I'm dead meat. You know, I'm gone as far as popular support is concerned and his political position within the country. So I think the first thing to sort of say in answer to your question is you have to recognize that's where he is. He's in an incredibly difficult position. So I suppose the advice I would give would be to try and move back from the heroic, we will fight to the last sort of Ukrainian type of thing to keep our country, and move back from that slightly, and at the same time edge forward a little bit in private, if it's possible, on the negotiating front, as in the original agreement that they were nearly reaching in 2022, because you know, as the American generals sort of recognize, you know, all wars have to end, and they end in two ways: either in the complete destruction of the country the war's taking place in, as in Afghanistan, or in some sort of negotiated settlement.
Well, as there are many people, an increasing number of people, I'd say, another winter coming, et cetera, that this war will end when Vladimir Putin decides it's over, not when things really change on the ground. And if indeed Putin is somewhat weakened politically, then he might need not to decide that the war in Ukraine is over.
Yeah, but I mean, there's this, I think a lot of people reading about the war think, the next bit of military equipment, the F-16s or whatever it is, that when they arrive, that will turn everything. Well, it won't. It'll just give more equality of air power, basically. It's not going to completely change the story. And when you think of the capacity of, say, China or North Korea, and the huge population of Russia, which Putin is willing to sacrifice in this thing, it is an unwinnable war, I think.
It has to be said, I think, that the Russian people are themselves becoming very fatigued with this conflict. A lot of Russians, particularly wealthy Russians, have actually fled the country already.
Yes,
we're seeing the spectacle of people openly expressing concern, asking why their menfolk, and it is largely menfolk, are still being sent to the front to what appears to be their death. Calculations are that over 100,000 Russian soldiers have lost their lives, and many more have been injured.
Yes.
So Putin, although he's in a strong position, is not completely invulnerable. And at some stage, public pressure, I would have thought, in Russia may well assert itself. So although certainly, as you say, Ian, Zelensky has got some pretty careful calculations to make. I think so has Putin, because he is not there indefinitely.
I do agree with you, but the casualties on the Ukrainian side, we don't really know, do we? Because obviously they're not being publicized, but it's pretty clear that they're taking very heavy casualties in this attempt to break through. And that can't just go on indefinitely without some sort of sense within the country that we're not getting anywhere very much. You know, taking a kilometer a month sort of thing and taking the sort of casualties, you could get that beginning to rear its head within Ukraine, what you're describing in Russia.
Michael Kimmich, just before we turn back to Mike Scott for a discussion of the questions that have come in, at the Kennan Institute, you surely have access to, if there's a think tank concerned with Russia that people will sit up and listen to, that's the one. And yes. So how do you evaluate Putin's options at this point?
Well, I would say that the situation is such that both countries are in for a very long war. I think the reason that Ukraine can't really negotiate, and I would very politely disagree with Ian about the prospects of negotiations in the first couple of weeks of the war. I don't think that they were especially bright for Ukraine. The reason that it's near impossible for Ukraine to negotiate in a way that would end the war has to do with the radicalism of the Russian war aims. And you can see from the Russian attacks on grain to the reunification efforts in occupied territories of Ukraine, the attacks on civilian infrastructure, you can see how all of this bespeaks a very radical project on Russia's part, which is at the very least to partition the country, if not in some way, to kind of dominate the territory of all of Ukraine. And sort of given that Ukraine, whether or not it has Western support, has really only one option, is to respond to the Russian invasion with force in whatever way it can. On the Russian side, not only the objectives not moderated since the beginning of the war, I think in some ways they may even have augmented. I think what Russia has discovered is that it has many capacities to fight this war. It has the tacit support of China, not direct, but tacit. It has a kind of support from India, Brazil, South Africa, and many other sizable, important countries. It's getting, through roundabout trade, all kinds of smuggling that's bringing in military material, sanctioned material, into Russia. There's an article in today's New York Times about enormous munitions production in Russia itself, outpacing European military production on certain kinds of ammunition in a very rapid way. The Russian economy has done fine throughout the war. The sanctions haven't really dented it. And most importantly for Putin, it's a popular war. Maybe it's artificially popular, maybe it's through manipulation. Maybe there's, you know, sort of something under the surface, as I was arguing at the beginning of this conversation, but for practical purposes, the war is popular. So I just see a 5, 10, 15, 20 year conflict in the making where both sides have both the capacity and the motivation to keep on fighting. It depresses me enormously to put this, to put the whole crisis in these terms, but that's to me where the evidence points.
That's a long war.
One of the things I wanted to ask you, well, not just you, Michael, but anybody, it's this, that at the beginning, the discourse from Russia was all about the expansion of NATO and the threat this was and having to deal with that threat. And, you know, coming from the George Kennan Institute yourself, don't have to remind you that what he said, that it would be a fateful error of American policy to engage in the expansion of NATO. So, I mean, in a very, very small way, the legitimation of some sort of response to the NATO advance was based on some degree of fact. NATO had advanced. It had taken in about 10 new countries, and it got right to the borders, and so on. And there was Romania and Austria, Romania, one other country with American missiles in, though they were defensive missiles and so on. Now it seemed to have mutated into the great imperial history being reincarnated by Putin, which is a much more, which in a way is not anything. It's not something that is an existential threat either to the United States or to the United Kingdom, but it's as sure as hell an existential threat to Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Georgia, and so on.
Ian, I'm going to interrupt you there. And before you answer that, Michael, I want to switch over to Mike Scott in Oxford, who may want to pick up those threads as he goes into the questions that have come in.
Mike, well, I do think that that last question is, thank you, Sandy. I do think that last question is quite an important question there, Ian. Does anybody on the panel, David, did you want to?
Well, yes, I did actually. And of course, there is always the danger of escalation through error. There was a report last week from Ukraine that a Russian drone had actually hit Romanian territory. Romania, of course, is a NATO member state. There are RAF planes based there. And it's arguable that something of that sort may be a bit more flagrant could result in the triggering of Article 4 of the NATO treaty. So that sort of thing is really terribly dangerous. What was quite interesting in that particular case was that immediately NATO denied that there had been any strike on Romanian territory, notwithstanding that Ukraine were quite clear that this drone had landed there. But it's a very perilous position, and we shouldn't rule out the prospect of escalation through cock-up.
Yeah.
Yeah, that brings us on to one of the questions that's come through, which is, how do we actually know what the truth is about this war? I mean, there are two aspects to that. How do we know what the truth is by what is being reported by the media? But more importantly, how do we know that the various governments in the West know what the truth is? How do we know that?
If I can come back on that, Mike, governments can only make an assessment. MPs get regular reports from the Ministry of Defence. And what I would say is that the reports that we get are reflected very, very closely in the media reports that we see in the newspapers and on TV. That's the only way that I can make an assessment, and that is that everything I hear from the media is actually corroborated by the stuff that I'm getting from the Ministry of Defence. But I can well understand that people would ask that question, because of course you're getting conflicting propaganda coming from both Ukraine and from Russia. And I think that all that we can do is to try to rely upon independent assessments from, for example, the American and British military.
Michael, please, yes. Michael, first, and then I'll come to Ian, yeah.
A comprehensive answer to your question. I just want to identify two problems when it comes to our understanding of the war. And the first is social media, which is in some ways revelatory. It brings images and videos and testimony very quickly to our attention, but is very skewed toward a certain kind of pro-Ukrainian story. We often get it filtered through, you can sort of see from the number of Ukrainian flags on people's social media sites, which is not an issue on an individual site, but the story of the war that we get through social media comes to us through a lot of filters. So we've seen thousands of Russian tanks being pulled by Ukrainian farmers, but there are lots of other images of the war that we don't necessarily see through social media. So it's not active manipulation, but it's more that you get kind of one side of the story. And then I think a lot of Western journalists feel emotionally close to the Ukrainian people and to the Ukrainian military, which I think I would if I would be over there. I mean, we're all human beings and have a position. It's no longer possible for most Western journalists to operate in Russia because of the conditions there. It would be impossible, I think, to embed with Russian units, or at the very least, very difficult for Western journalists. And so the emotions of the story come to us in wartime from one particular side. And you do have to be very concerned, again, not about the nature of sympathy, that's human, but you have to be very concerned about accuracy and putting forward the awkward detail and you know, issues of corruption, perhaps in the Ukrainian military, or setbacks. And as was mentioned earlier, we just don't know about casualties and a lot of key figures. It's a kind of joke in Washington that you hear that people know more about the Russian military than they do about the Ukrainian military in the course of this war, which is a bit perplexing, but speaks to the kind of media landscape in which we're operating.
Ian, you muted, Ian. You muted.
The quote is, I looked it up actually, and it's not what we think it is, but it is actually the first casualty when war comes is truth. It's not the first casualty of war is truth. It's the first casualty when war comes is truth. And that is obviously true. And it's obviously a fundamental difficulty for both war correspondents and political analysts and so on, because there are certain types of thing that if you say it, you're really quite likely to have a quite a wide attack in the social media. In the past, in the sort of Vietnam War, Afghan War, you could lose your job with NBC if you spoke out in a particular way against the war, or expressed yourself badly in what you were saying. And I think the loss of truth is all about omission, usually, as well as sort of particularly positive propaganda about what you're doing. And if you ask yourself, what's the omission? Well, I suppose it's as you say, it'll be casualty figures from your own side. I remember when the coffins were coming back from Afghanistan, no television company was allowed to be there as the coffins with the American flag came off the plane. I think they allowed one picture of it, or maybe two pictures of it, but that's a sort of pretty fundamental thing. The other, of course, is the huge, and I'm going to sound like a lefty now, the military industrial complex. It's the Lockheed Martins that are not really written about. And I've discovered it was very, very interesting that there was quite a debate about the expansion of NATO. And Bruce Jackson, who was head of Lockheed Martin, led the committee to expand NATO and lobbied the American government when there was a sort of debate about it. And we do have to, I think of the enormous profits that these large corporations that supply armaments are making out of this. And just bear in mind, there are plenty of people who do not wish this war to end.
Well, Anna, there's a kind of a moral issue that you might like to just comment on.
I think there's some really good points there. I think the first thing that I was thinking about as Ian was talking actually was to do with journalism, and especially in Ukraine, self-censorship of journalists and sort of journalists who've reported that they might find that there's corruption, but they don't want to report it because it's going to harm the war effort, all of these sorts of things. So I think that's one issue, and I suppose trying to think around that, how do we support independent voices here? I think the other one, I think again sort of back to what Ian was saying about this casualty of war, who's being the casualty of war. I think especially in Russia, we might want to ask it the other way around, and how does the cancellation of truth lead to violence? Because when that free speech is suppressed or dissident voices are suppressed, that can lead to a lot of, as we've seen, disinformation campaigns and propaganda. It's very hard then to sort of separate fact from fiction and difficult to sort of perhaps not buy into the narratives that you're being told. So I think that's another fact. And the other one that I just wanted to touch on was also this idea of conscientious objection, or people voicing their dissent, not necessarily against one side, but just against war in general. And I think that can be very hard, and is often branded as being disloyal or anti-nationalist when it isn't necessarily. And I think probably that we see that on both sides. And part of, I think the what's come out with the corruption in Ukraine is people sort of paying people in the military to be taken over the border or not to go into war. And part of that, I think, tells us about the trauma of it. not wanting to be part of this? And what are those voices? Can we sort of think about what those voices are telling us? Perhaps the ones that aren't being highlighted. I don't know if anyone wants to pick up on that. Or
cluster bomb story, you know, actually sending cluster bombs. When you see what cluster bombs did to Kosovo and Bosnia and so on, and the years and years it takes, and the children with legs blown off, you know, years after the cluster bombs have been fired against the enemy. I mean, there is a real moral issue there, it seems to me, within military practice. But there's also, I think, something that I find very, very difficult, but we've seen it played out more in Latin America, and that is the moral jeopardy of allowing war crimes to go unpunished. But very often that's the price of peace. And I think that's an enormously difficult thing, and be very, very difficult for the Ukrainians to actually have to pay that price. I think that would be quite a, and the war crimes are so severe in this, well, they are in all wars, but it's particularly bad, isn't it? I don't know what you think about that, but South Africa was very interesting in that, had a truth commission, but chances of truth commissions in Russia is completely for the birds.
Of course, a warrant has been issued for the arrest of Vladimir Putin for...
Exactly.
I don't know how long that'll take to be executed.
Yeah. Another question that came in, it was a bit earlier on when it said, did Russia have any legitimate right at all to invade? I mean, was it just Vladimir Putin deciding that he wanted to be some kind of hero and so on and reclaim lost lands and so on? Was there any legitimacy, though, felt within Russia, amongst people in Russia, that this was a necessary thing to do? Yes, please, Michael.
I think there are two answers to the question, sort of a philosophical answer, and then as you're asking about, Michael, a kind of practical answer from a Russian point of view, as best as we can understand it. I think philosophically speaking, there's no justification for war. Ukraine posed no threat to Russia. There was no danger in which Russia was in the years before the war. And, you know, we could devote a whole hour and 15 minutes to talking about NATO and NATO enlargement, NATO expansion. Yeah. The simple fact is that Ukraine was not slated for NATO expansion, although statements had been made in that direction. A lot of the diplomacy had been bungled. I think if Russia had stood down in February 2022 instead of invading, they probably could have gotten a kind of promise from France and Germany, and maybe even from the US, that Ukraine would never become a part of NATO. So if that was the issue, which is the one that Putin has put forward, in addition to a lot of fabulous issues, such as Ukrainians committing genocide against Russians in the Donbas, you know, there were other ways of handling it than by going to war. So I can't see any sort of justification for what Russia has done, let's say, in our terms, as opposed to Putin's terms, or maybe more generally Russian terms. But it has been a popular war, and that does tell us something about Russian attitudes toward Ukraine, toward the United States, toward Europe. That's, of course, significant. But the reason I find it so complicated to judge on the Russian side, you know, Russia being now a dictatorship, and so the will of the chief executive matters so greatly there, I do think that if Russians had had the choice on the 23rd of February, 2022, to go to war in Ukraine or not, I think 95% of Russians would have said no. I don't think that there was a movement in Russia to go to war on the eve of the war. Now, once the war begins, you have a rally around the flag effect, you have anti-war sentiment, you have people not wanting to lose. I can very easily understand why Russians wouldn't want to lose the war. Most Americans didn't want to lose the war in Vietnam either, even if they came to object to it or feel that it was an immoral or wrong war. So we kind of are where we are now in terms of Russian public opinion, which is pro-Putin enough for Putin's sake. But the Russian story on this is a complicated one. And I think if Russia were more democratic, I don't think the war would have taken place.
Yeah, I really agree with that.
Do you? And David, do you
yes, I do. That? I do. Yeah, I think it is exactly. I think Michael's put it very, very well, actually. That, I mean, there are all these circumstances about NATO, and they provided. I mean, the damaging aspect of it was that it provided a very good excuse initially for it, however spurious. But I think there was amongst the military a sort of a feeling of being surrounded. I mean, when you go back to the Kennedy days, you know, the deal was, you know, take your missiles out of Turkey and we'll pull back from we'll pull our missiles out of Cuba. And I think the trouble is that if you're in a very Soviet mindset, you're in the back of the envelope stuff at Yalta, all about, you know, this is your sphere and this is my sphere. And I think he's got that in his head, really, that it's his sphere. And he, I mean, I was looking at the population figures for Latvia, Lithuania and Estonia. And they're all 1 million, 1.8 million or 2 million. And Latvia Estonia, a quarter of the population identify ethnically as Russian, and they must be in a sort of Sudetenland type of danger, really, if as a potential. But then, of course, that would trigger a NATO response. But and they are fearful. I mean, the Estonians are really fearful.
Actually, what you mentioned there, President Kennedy, and Victoria Mumford-Smith sent a question in. Do you think that President Kennedy would have handled the situation of the Russian invasion of Ukraine any differently from the present methods of the Western world?
That's a good question.
It's
very tough one, Mike.
It's always extremely difficult. I mean, you know, the alternative history problem. You know, you really can't come up with a cogent answer. I mean, Chou En-lai was asked once what he thought would have happened if it hadn't been Kennedy who was assassinated, but Khrushchev, and he thought briefly, and then he said, "Well, I don't think that Aristotle Onassis would have married Mrs. Khrushchev." So you can't give an answer to a question like that.
Michael, yeah.
I think the only answer I could give is that I don't think policy-wise Kennedy would have had different or new ideas relative to those that are out there with Western leadership. What Kennedy had was eloquence. And actually that's missing on the part of all the relevant figures at the moment. It's certainly missing President Biden. I mean, Olaf Scholz, I think, doesn't aspire to eloquence. Maybe Macron comes the kind of closest, but he's not a figure who can really give the speech to put people behind the war. So going back to Sandy's earlier questions about war fatigue, you know, one of the answers to war fatigue is just brilliant stylistic political leadership. That is not in great supply at the moment. In the West, that may be a deficit, and it may over time be a kind of costly deficit. So the kind of speech that Kennedy gave in Berlin in 1963 that really kept people on board with certain policies, and that's not there. So in addition to Aristotle Onassis, you know, and wonderful joke, that might be the meaning of Kennedy's presence if he were around today.
Yeah. Any other
time? I mean, people say Ronald Reagan is famous for saying, "Mr. Putin, tear down this wall." One has to wonder what he might say to Putin today in this situation. If he were, I mean, there are a lot of ifs there.
Well, Miller has been talking to Grasimov. I mean, there has been some sort of attempt at diffusing situations at the level of the heads of the military. But I don't know to what extent there's any back. I mean, the whole Kennedy thing depended on back channels and so on. I'm just a bit worried that they're not there in quite the same way. They may be. I mean, how would we know?
Thank you for that. There's another question in which we've tended to talk about already, but I think the way that Sebastian de Hoek has put it is interesting. How did the whole Prigozhin murder play out. Surely a man like Prigozhin would have had some sort of life insurance, e.g. scandalous information on Putin when he negotiated the withdrawal of his troops during the march on Moscow. Did Putin manage to deactivate, or is it that Prigozhin was just stupid?
That's stupid.
Is that what you think? Stupid.
Well, I do think it's quite incredible, you know, under the circumstances, as I said earlier on, to get on an aeroplane and without really checking for bombs, if you were in that position, you know. And that was very, very strange. Not stupid. Being a fantasist is stupid, I suppose, but he clearly is a cunning man. But there's bits missing when it comes to sort of rational decisions.
I think that the most remarkable aspect of that episode was the fact, as I said earlier, that when the march stopped, Putin didn't immediately arrest Prigozhin and shot, which is what you'd expected. That would have underlined Putin's own strength. The fact that didn't happen tends to make me think that there was some weakness that we probably don't know about yet prevented him from doing so, and that Putin had to resort to the time-honored method of assassination by stealth, which is what he allegedly does to people who oppose his regime.
Well, thank you. Thank you for that. I'm going to hand back and ask Sandy if he wants to say anything. It's coming towards the end now. Sandy, do you want to?
We're pressing up against our deadline, but I want to thank everybody for this wonderful conversation. It really, it sort of underlines for me how little we know, as someone said earlier, and how this has faded from the center of dialogue discussion. Probably not for Michael Kimmage, given the position he's in, but for an awful lot of people, I think they're saying, oh, that's still going on, is it? Anyway, thanks to all of you for your wisdom. Very nice to have David Jones coming directly from the House of Commons to talk about this and to have everybody giving us the time. As usual, I want to thank Georgetown University for its steadfast support of these monthly programs. I think Mike said earlier, this is our 34th one in a row since we started the series deep in the pandemic. And judging from some circles, we may be in a pandemic again before too long. There's a lot of COVID. So we have to keep it going, Mike, just in case. And we will. So thank you, Mike, and thanks to everyone here at Georgetown and all the backup you have in Oxford, Mike, and of course to John McCabe here in Washington, keeps the series going while juggling a lot of other bills here as well.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Sandy, for keeping with this whole series. It's been tremendous. The next speech project at the Crossroads International Dialogue event in association with the Future of the Humanities Project will be on Wednesday the 11th of October, when we will be discussing democracy in the USA. What is going on? What is happening at the moment with all what is the international response to this? What do people think about it internationally? Because every day there seems to be some news about an arrest or other, or an impeachment or other. It's just strange, maybe, to people. And so we want to investigate that and have a look at to see what people from outside the United States might be thinking about the United States at the present time. If you're in the Washington area, please note that on the 26th of September at 5 p.m. in the Riggs Library of Healy Hall, Georgetown University, there will be a guest lecture by Dr. Claire Broome Saunders from Blackfriars Hall at Oxford University. The inescapable lure of the medieval politics, pictures and poetics in the long 19th century. And it's interesting in terms of free speech, because what she's going to be talking about is the way that writers used medieval images, chivalric images, Arthurian images, and so on, to make political points as we moved into that period of the Great War and to the end of the Great War. How they were actually saying things in a kind of a code, a referring to medieval icons, medieval literature, and so on. I think it's a fascinating subject, and I hope you'll come along to that if you're anywhere near Georgetown University, 5 p.m. 26th of September in the Riggs Library. My thanks to colleagues at Georgetown, to the President Jack DeJoy, and to Tom Banchoff. A Blackfriars to John O'Connor, the Regent, and to Richard Finn, the Director of the Las Casas Institute. A Campion Hall to Dr. Nick Austin, the Master of Campion Hall. Thanks from me also to colleagues at Georgetown, in particular for John McCabe for making this happen, and to those people over in Oxford, including Maggie, my wife, who helps administer this program from our side. So thank you, Ian, Michael, David, Anna, for a terrific conversation this afternoon, and thank you, Sandy, and thank you for tuning in, and we hope that you'll tune in again on the 11th of October. And if you're there on the 26th of September and you've come along, please introduce yourselves to us. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Mike. Bye-bye.